John, the 21st chapter, starting with the first verse, we're going to read 1 through 7, and then we're going to go 15 through 19. John 21, starting with verse 1. Just a hint, it's in the New Testament. Amen. Amen. Still saved?
Still saved.
All right, I'll read and you'll follow. It says, afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. Now here it is. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them, and they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore. But the disciples did not realize it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered, and he said, throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off and jumped into the water. Let us go to 15. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt. Because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Hear this. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hand. And someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. Lord, add a blessing to the reading and to the hearing of his most holy, holy word. Our sermonic theme today is the price of love. The price of love. Let me be clear, church, that the nature of our biblical canon indicates that when persons enter into relationship with God, there is a change. Yes, yes. It is the desire that an old life in old ways pass away with an insatiable desire for a new life with God. The connection with God makes it impossible if it is a true connection. Okay. To desire anything but God's favor and his grace. There must be a change. A significant moment that you can't go back to what you were. You always are now moving forward to what you can be. The Bible is strong on this, church. Abraham, upon his covenant, could not re-enter his old home.
That's right.
He would have to move forward to the promised land. The covenant would not allow him to go back. It could only go forward. Joseph, after being rescued from the jail, could no longer be the little brother and farm boy. No, he would have to be elevated up into the high ranks of Pharaoh's court in order that he could enact and feed his own people. The great Moses, after the burning bush, could no longer return to the solitude and the peace of the shepherd's field. He would have no choice but to lead the people to the promised land, even if it would kill him in the process. The warrior David, upon the slaying of Goliath, could no longer go back to the boy in the fields. He would have to become king whether he would like it or not. The prophet Isaiah, upon answering those powerful words and saying, "Here I am, send me," could not back out of his covenant. He must now go forward and proclaim God's word to his own people, even if they would ridicule and come against him. Jeremiah could no longer be a boy. All the prophets, upon making their declaration for the Lord, would be forever changed. The nature of their lives could no longer be the same. There must be a change. The sad thing with this scripture is that the disciples were the first to walk with Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
They defied the biblical expectations. Christ called them and said, "Follow me, I will make you fishers of men," meaning that there would be a greater calling of healing for the people of this earth. They saw miracles and they saw him teach. They saw his heart. They saw everything about him. They saw the whipping and the beating. They saw his crucifixion and resurrection. And now here these guys are back to fishing. They went back to their comfort level. They went back to what they were pulled from. And now here they are on a boat in the middle of the water fishing and can't catch no fish. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. People out here need to be fed. These are the same disciples when needing to be fed. They argued about where they were going to sit in heaven, whether it would be on the right hand or on the left hand. They witnessed a boy being possessed with demons, couldn't even get the demons out of them. They had to go to Jesus. And my brother Jesus, with his death pendant, said, "Can't you just stay awake a little while I get up here and pray?"
Hallelujah.
Then to sit there and have a meal with the person who would betray him.
Yes, Lord.
And then to sit across from the same one who would deny him.
Right.
And then they would abandon him. It takes, they break the mold, church, of the biblical expectations. And yet here in this last chapter of John 21, after Christ has appeared already twice, still that's not enough for them to understand
that they can't go back to fishing. When Christ found them, they weren't catching fish in the first place. Now here they are back fishing and they still ain't catching no fish.
Oh, church, yeah. Is this not us?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Come into church and shout all over the place. End up right back in the same sin you was doing before you showed up at church in the morning. Is this not us, church, praising God on Sunday, drugged up and drunk out by Monday? Is this not us, church, testifying that I finally got it and that I'm finally done with this man, I'm finally done with this woman, and then crawl back into the same bed with the same joker you didn't like in the first place? Christ is the greatest thing that happened to me. My life is so different because he came into my life. But yet still can't come to church. Is this not us, church? With the responsibility now to leave a prior life and a prior way of thinking, a prior way of moving. But yet we continue to deny Christ. And end up back into the same mess that we were in the first place. Salvation means that you are saved from something. If you're still doing the same thing you were doing, then you need to check your salvation. If your friends are still the same friends that you had while you were sinning, you need to check your friends. Salvation is a serious thing. Yes, some people can't make the journey. I was like that. Let me get everybody saved. That way I won't be by myself. Let's go to verses 3 and 4. Look at what it says here, church. I'm going out to fish. Simon told them. They said, hear this now, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat and they caught nothing. But early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore. But the disciples didn't even realize it was Jesus. We may forget Christ, but he sure don't forget us. You may be fishing and not doing what God is supposed to have you doing. But Christ will find a way to show up and get all up in your business. Because you see, once he touches you, there is a connection that he can't break away from you. And his word will show up at inconvenient, unexpected times. And you'll think you're done with the church. And then you'll hear something like, greater is he that is in me than he who is in the world. All good things work together for the good of those that love the Lord and whom are called according to his purpose. Don't ever worry, church. In this thing, in the church, there's nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. And here his disciples are trying to hide at night on the water, and they can't even be successful at it. Don't ever worry, church. Not only will God show up, but he'll keep beating you up. God will just keep poking you. Like, stop, God, I don't want to. Stop, God. Stop, I don't want to. I'm not trying. You're trying to talk loud, so you can't hear God. Blah, 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 blah. God, you can't go longer than where God can go. I used to have this friend, he was baptized. He was baptized in like 2002. But the water, he went down in the water. And he came up with it. But he kept getting into the same problems
year after year, time after time. But it was when he had to do that prison stint that something clicked in him on the inside. And see, jail will do it to you. Because see, when you in a place you can't get out of, it'll do something to you. And even though you don't think about it, you'll find yourself on your knees and say, Lord, if you would just deliver me this time, I won't ever get in trouble ever again. He will find us. Peter, church, is still suffering. The guilt of the denial has still overcome him. He lost his Savior. Then he played into his demise. He hadn't forgiven himself. He was wounded. He can't move forward. And he can't get to the fishing of me. He's gone back to fishing for fish. Christ has to re-engage with him to let him know that it's okay. You got to let it go. Church, there are those of us in here or outside, we're wounded. Heartbreak wounds us. Job loss, no money, wounds us. And it pains us to the point that we can't move forward. Because the hurt is so great. No new people can love us because we don't trust them. We can't forgive because we don't want to. We want to hold on to the hate. We want to hold on to the dislike. Some of us have buried people and we're still at the grave. They've gone on to glory and we're still there at the grave. Peter is in that same situation. Even though he has witnessed it, even though he has seen it, he's still at the grave. And what's terrible about it is he initiated the fishing trip. And they all came with him. If Peter goes, then we go. So now you've got people who's supposed to be doing God's work.
Okay.
And they're sitting out there wasting time. Come on, let's go to 15. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?
Okay.
Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Jesus, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Take care of my sheep. Jesus, third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He was hurt. Do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. I love you. Feed my sheep. Christ is saying that it's okay to move forward. But loving me is not sitting around twiddling your fingers. Loving me is not sitting around indicting one another. Going off on our brothers and our sisters. Loving me is getting beyond yourself and feeding these sheep. They don't have, look, a sheep, lamb, they're not predators. They don't have the capacity to get out and predator and kill their own food. That's why they need a shepherd to help them. The more you are distracted with your own personal situation and greed, the more the work does not get done. When person becomes self-absorbed, Christ is indicating, get over yourself. Oh, what he's saying is, if you love me, put aside yourself. Okay. Look. Your greed, your issues, we know it's painful, but you got to carry out the mission. Go ye therefore. God is telling us to move beyond the hate, the discontent, the concern, the hurt from the past. Because you out here fishing, there's sheep that need to hear a word.
That's right.
There's sheep that need to be equipped and loved. There's sheep that need to be adored. When the shepherd is not there for the sheep, the wolves and the lions come in and devour. Oh, but when the sheep moves away from the flock and gets out there by themselves, the wolves and the lion devour also. Oh, I have to believe sheep are just like any other animal. They don't always agree. They just stay together. He said, the final point is this. There's a price that we pay for loving Jesus. The Bible says faith without works is what? Faith without works is what? Works is the manifestation of your love for Christ. Because then you seek to live and be like him. There's no way that any human being in any flesh could absorb that kind of pain.
Hallelujah.
If they were thinking of themselves.
Lord.
Come on, let's go to verse 18. Verily I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went where you wanted. But when you are old, he telling them, you will stretch out your hand and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. And Jesus said, this indicates the kind of death that Peter will suffer on his behalf. But then he says to him, follow me.
Follow me.
Oh yeah, he wasn't going to let him off the hook.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, follow me. Right. I'm telling you this is what's going to happen, but I'm not going to let you go. Whatever pond you pull in the fish, I'm going to be right there. Wherever you walk, I mean, if I can get to your brother Jonah, and if I can get to the well, surely I can get to you. You're not going to be able to let me go. But just follow me. Remember here, church, look. When Christ got on that shore, they wasn't catching no fish. When Christ spoke, they caught fish on the right side. He's saying that I'm going to take care of you. You just got to trust me. You have got to trust me. They had no fish in the nets. The Bible talks about 153 fish. The nets, there were so many that really the net should have broke. But the net wouldn't break. Church, those of us called to serve in ministry are going to understand this, because Christ indicates that there will be struggle on his behalf.
That's right.
It'll be struggle in this church, and it's going to be struggle outside this church. Your family will abandon you. Your friends will talk about you. History and scholars will say that Peter refused to die like Christ. If you don't nail me to a cross, turn me upside down. Because I'm not worthy to stand up there like Christ, who gave his life for me. All of those personas that we indicated in the beginning of this talk, church, they didn't go back to the comfort of their couches in the home. And they were not perfect people. We can go through the imperfection of every last one of them who we did. But they had to stay true to the mission. Imagine David now is being sought after by his mentor Saul. When he finally gets in, he sleeps with Bathsheba, has to watch his own son die. He has to watch incest and rape going on in his own family, but still he didn't give up the throne. Sunday morning and doing nothing is attractive. Except for if you're working for Christ.
That's right.
All of us would like to sit on home, and all of us would like the pleasure of Sunday. But some of us can't sit home no more, because Christ is on the shore asking us, what in the world are we doing? If you love me, feed them. If you do love me, then keep my commandments. Live as I told you to live. There's a price that will be paid for the love, but welcome to the game. If your feelings are hurt, good, welcome to the game. If you got heartache in the process, welcome to the game. If you're unsure, if it's against you, I don't know what tomorrow will be. Welcome to the game. For every minister, for every deacon, for every trustee, for every officer, struggle is upon us.
But that's just the price that we pay for love. Look, I love Jesus. I don't want to let him down. You know, I just, you know, I could take you talking about me. When Jesus is talking about me, I don't like that man. If you trust him, he will provide. Hear me on this. I'll be out your way. Look, y'all know I'm a grandmother lover. And I've been going through these old pictures and all this. And it's just been getting to me, but it's making me remember a lot of stories from my family. Growing up in Chicago in the 70s and early 80s, there was this thing where you could go around and collect aluminum cans. And then you take them to the grocery store and you could turn them in for money. That was like the early recycling. Amen. You know, my grandmother took it to a whole new level. Because she was one of the ones that had a red wagon truck with about 3 or 4 big trash bags full of cans and would take them to the grocery store. And I had a cousin named Rocket, and what she would do is that she would get us, whenever we would go over to her house, she would wake us up in the morning and get us up and say, "We going out to collect cans." Now you got to get this here, church, because collecting cans is an embarrassing endeavor, because you're walking through the park, you're getting cans out the garbage can, you're going around, she has her little pointer where she puts it down in the can, she had it so good she could put about 5 cans just on one pointer, and she gets us out there and she's having us get the cans, and our friends are waving, look at them over there getting them cans with that lady. And so one time we were going, we said, "Grandma, we don't want to go." And then she pulled that grandma thing on us. This is, y'all probably use it all the time. "Do you love me? Do you love me?" "Well, yeah, we love you." "Well, then get that bag and get yourself up and get out here and get these kids." Church, we was out, and this just seemed to be the worst day, church, because it was like a picnic and everybody was outside. You want to do it under the cover of night or early in the morning, not late morning, noon, we out here like this. And she's like, "Oh, we gonna clean up today. Look how many people are in the park with the RC colas and the Pepsi and the cans being thrown around." This was before you could get arrested for littering. We got up to the grocery store and we took all them cans up there to that man. And she came back with the money.
Okay.
And she gave every penny. She split it half between me and my cousin. We said, "Grandma, what you doing?" She said, "Because you stuck with me." Oh, help me, hold it. "Because you didn't quit on me. Because you didn't run away from me." And even though your friends mocked you and talked about you and yelled and said those things to you, you still didn't leave your grandma. And that's all Christ is saying. Look, if you love me, don't worry about what your friends say. Don't worry about what your other brothers and sisters in Christ say. If you love me,